Let's start with the epithelia. My time starts now. Now you see, when you look at epithelium and you talk about simple cuboidal epithelium, maybe we should have a scene and a background like this. Or when you look at the gallbladder and you want to talk about really, really tall pillar-like cells, maybe this may be a better slide than a conventional slide. Now here, this is salivary glands. I have very interest, particularly taken it because the contrast is beautiful. You can see I have highlighted four areas in circles. Those are the myoepithelial cells, not routinely seen, but then here there is a good contrast, hence I am able to identify that. These myoepithelial cells form a wire mesh like structure around the acinus, the contraction of which really crushes the acinus to release its contents into the immediately available duct. Now, this is a slide of a stratified squamous epithelium, keratinized epithelium. The comparison that I have given here is like the cobblestones of a walking footpath in a park or where you can see the way the grass is in between. That roughly gives you an idea of those prickle cells. Or you can even consider this like to be attached roof, particularly when you look at the keratinization. In contrast, a non-keratinized stratified epithelium has no keratin and the surface looks like glazed tiles of a building. A third appropriate comparison would be urothelium or the transitional epithelium, where the top row of cells are in a bulged condition or umbrella-like cells. So you can consider this to be another example for comparison. This is from the ureter. Next, this is probably the best way of understanding the secretory columnar cells. Whenever we talk of pyramidal cells, it may be any gland or a glandular component of some other organ like intestine, whatever it is. This may be an appropriate way of looking at secretory epithelium. Therefore, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take you on a journey from known to unknown and make you comfortable in this journey of understanding the histology which you already know. Now, the same thing, serous cells, you can see it is uniformly eosinophilic stained and there are granules, same in a cross section of a citrus fruit. Now, this is one of the most interesting slides. I have always had a problem telling my students what exactly is the meaning of foamy cells. Basically, we know why it is foamy, because the alcohol has washed out the mucus material in the granules. As a result, it presents a ghostly appearance or a whitish appearance. The best example may be that cup of milk or coffee. Where, you know, when you go to a hotel, they not only serve the hot milk on a cup, they will make sure, you watch carefully, that he will nicely mix it. At the end, he will add a little bit of froth, leftover froth on the top of the milk. And if it is coffee, he will add one spoon of decoction on it so that it creates a pattern. Now, that will be probably the best example of understanding how the simple pyramidal cells or the mucus cells will look like. Now, this no other fruit can give you a better example of neuroepithelial cells or the taste buds that you see in the tongue. Or, for that matter, here is a high contrast, very high magnification, not possible in a conventional student microscope. I have used a trinocular microscope, a little high-end equipment, and you can see the cilia of the uterine tube. microvilli, that is the columnar cells of the duodenum. Although it is not so clearly visible as in the case of the previous one, at least by inference, you can look at the comparative example to understand the concept of microvilli. So also stereocilia. Now you see the picture, the background clearly tells you that the stereocilia is a very rigid surface projection, unlike the cilia. Now that is the point I want you to note in this. It doesn't matter now where is this example from. We know it is from the epididymis as an excellent example. Next, nerve histology. As I told you, I am going to take you to something that is not routinely seen or that is something routinely missed in a traditional light microscopy. That's why the topic is going beyond the horizon. Now, this is a silver stain. I repeat, this is a silver stain. And you can see the very good contrast and the node of Ranveer. That is when we realize the node alone is not the only thing there. There are so many other things in addition, accessories to this node like these. Now, this is an example of how we understand the node, just like petrol wagons of a railway train. Now, we see it is not only the node, there is an internode, there is a para node, and juxta para node. Next. Difficult, but in a good contrast and a very thin slide of a H&E preparation, this Schmidt-Lanterman incisors can be seen. But you see, when I use a silver stain, you can see that beautifully. Now, these are nothing but decompacted islands in the myelin sheath that contains a Schwann cell cytoplasm. Normally, in a routine H&E light microscopy, low power or even in high power, we stop with showing the node of Ranveer. But if you search carefully, you may be able to identify a Schmidt-Lanterman incisor. Now, this is a very interesting sign, TSF nerve. The perineurium has been particularly highlighted because it is believed that it is the metabolic and immunological barrier of a nerve, because to the best of my knowledge, blood vessels are never seen deep to this area. That means blood vessels are there only outer to the perineurium. Next, bone transverse section. Now, looks beautiful. Unfortunately, it is all the local fruit available, that is roasted peanuts. You can see I have arranged it as if it looks like a Haversian system. And I have put a coffee, plate, you know, on which you keep a cup of coffee as the central Haversian canal. Remember, in other words, what I'm trying to give you is an inferential approach to understanding certain concepts in histology. Now, when I blow up those areas which I showed in circle, you can see each peanut in its complete, with its capsule, is our, a component of the Haversian system, and the cell that is inside it is the osteocyte. This was done on an experimental basis for photography purposes, but then I purchased 2 kgs of roasted peanuts, and after the photography, the whole department enjoyed having a nice snack. Hyaline cartilage. The way I present hyaline cartilage to my students is something they love to eat, namely the raspberry cake. You see, compare the histology and the cake, you can see the territorial matrix, and marked in yellow, you can see the interterritorial matrix. On the cake, it doesn't matter because both resemble each other. You can learn either from the cake or you can learn directly from the histology slide. Therefore, this is a cake view approach to understanding the hyaline cartilage, or for that matter, what is popular among students and of course faculty like me are these chickies. Now, a cross section of the chickie will give you more or less a similar picture. What you see as interterritorial metrics can be seen, and whatever you see as lacuna are seen as white spots in the peanut chocolate. Now, the best way you can link and remember loose areolar tissue is this kind of, shall we say, raw salad. Not only that, if you can add a few fruits into it, you can even